Hi, my name is Michael. I work on AI for veterinary health at Mars, and today I'm very excited to talk to you about our work in radiology and how we leverage PyTorch. So you might already know and enjoy some of Mars products, for example, M&Ms or Snickers. But what you might not know is that Mars has 100,000 associates working in pet care, thinking about how to create a better world for pets every day. Mars also has a growing network of 2,500 veterinary clinics and hospitals in 20 countries. And Antec Diagnostics, a company that focuses on delivering high-quality diagnostics and imaging solutions to the whole veterinary industry. We found working in this environment, this tightly integrated ecosystem, very beneficial when it comes to building AI systems. It's easy for us to connect to doctors, to get their help, to start projects with them, and to learn from them. There's so much we can learn from them, and we're learning from them every day. When it comes to deployment of our models, it's good that everyone working alongside the clinical value chain shares the same goals, shares the same principles. That's a situation that's very different from what you often hear from colleagues that work in human healthcare. Now, the pet population has grown enormously over the last years, and especially in the last 2 years. And while this is amazing for pets and pet parents, it also means that there's much more demand for high-quality healthcare for those pets. Now, on the other side, the supply side, that's extremely hard to match because it just takes time to educate a board-certified radiologist, for example. Now, that's one of the major facts why we find our work so rewarding, so interesting. Being able to build AI systems that support these amazing radiologists, these amazing veterinarians to be more efficient, to deliver more care to more pets, it's really what motivates us in the end. Now, in medical imaging, you often hear a paradigm that you only need a relatively small amount of data, has to be very high label quality, of course, but then you're basically good because those images are so much more standardized than natural images. Now, we found through experiments that this is not the case in our use case. We need a certain volume of data, otherwise we don't get the robustness that we need in production. And we have organized our data in different subsets based on label quality. The largest data set subset is the so-called NLP data, or NLP labeled data. Here we use an algorithm that we built based on work that has been done at Stanford, where we extract labels from radiology reports. And then we can use those labels together with the images to train our algorithms. Now, this process is inherently noisy. And we also have a data set, the so-called silver data, where each image is individually labeled by a radiologist. We have 250,000 images in this data set. That doesn't sound that much, especially if we work in medical in natural images, but it already matches some of the larger academic data sets in radiology and human radiology in size, but has way better label quality. Then we also have a platinum data set, small test data set. It's every image is labeled by multiple radiologists, and we use this basically to assess the radiologist by radiologist variability and assess our models against that. We find using distillation really helps our training process. We use ideas from noisy student, combine those with earlier research on distillation. What we basically do is we take our best model, we predict all the images in our NLP label data set, and then we combine the NLP labels with our predicted labels. And we found that this leads to better results than only training on NLP label data or only training on distillation or noisy student style distillation. In inference, we found that using a fairly large ensemble really helps our robustness and also the accuracy for at least some of the findings. We have a couple of different feature extractors that are quite dissimilar from each other. and we use those to extract features. Then we combine those features with information about view, position, and body part that we obtained from earlier models, combine everything into 53 predictions. Now, 53 is not a number set in stone. It's always evolving, dependent on the feedback that we get from radiologists and veterinarians. We care a lot about data drift. We run our models now for months and months in shadow mode and have tested on tens of thousands of images while adding new regions, new hospitals to our pipeline. We found basically no decline in predictive in accuracy or other important metrics for us. We found this very interesting because that's very different than from what you often read in the literature. Now, we made a couple of different experiments. One of those is that we took an autoencoder, we trained it on a subset of our data, and then we predicted on an independent test set, and then looked at the reconstruction error. Now, we started, the first training subset was only coming from one hospital, from one organization. And then we added organization after organization and redid the whole process and looked at how the reconstruction error was evolving. And through this experiment and others, we have good evidence that you really need a certain diversity of organizations in your data to get to a place where you have a robust enough models for production. Looking at the overall performance of our models, on this slide you can see the little symbols symbolize the predictions from radiologists for different findings, and then the curves symbolize the model predictions. And you can see that we already match radiologists for many important findings. And we see this all across different abnormalities we test on. The model I just talked about is only one of many in our production platform. Now, we have models that predict body part, we have models that predict view position, we have models that predict the correct orientation of an image and reorients that to help the radiologist to be more efficient, for example. And we also use historical information from the patient in question and combine this with the predictions that our models produce to create a contextualized assessment per case and send that back to the veterinarians. When it comes to PyTorch, I like to say that we came for the dynamic graph, but we stayed for the ecosystem. And we have been PyTorch early adopters. We really loved it in the beginning for rapid prototyping, but we definitely are amazed on how good it is now to bridge development and production. We built a complete training stack for this project with PyTorch and Hydra to make it very easy to configure. And we also, in production, we also really like to work with TorchScript, because TorchScript makes it very easy for us to hide some of the complexity of these large ensembles that we use. And also because it's very performant. Everything that drives performance there helps us a lot as well. And then just in general, the ecosystem. I mean, in this project, we use Torch Vision, we use MMF, we use Detektron 2, we use Captain for model interpretability. It just amazed on how well the ecosystem has grown, and really want to thank you all, either working on PyTorch Core and being so helpful when we have any questions, or all the ecosystem projects out there. Now, to give you an overview, at the moment we have 21 networks running on the whole X-ray or radiology platform. We do inference on around 15,000 images a day, and have already been done inference on 3.5 million images in total. The current system, and that's mainly coming from the reorientation of the images, already saves over 1,000 radiologist hours per year, which is amazing if you think back in the beginning on how scarce that resource is. I also want to point out that AI for veterinary health at Mars is way broader than what I just presented to you. Colleagues of us have developed and deployed a system that can predict chronic kidney disease in cats up to 2 years earlier than traditional diagnostic tools. We work in ECGs, other modalities in radiology, for example, dental or CTs or MRIs. And we recently deployed a system in pathology and also published about that experience. If you're interested to dive deeper into those topics, I listed some resources for you. If you otherwise just wanted to communicate about AI and veterinary health, please reach out on social. Very happy to have that conversation. And last but not least, thanks for listening and thanks for all your great work on the PyTorch and PyTorch ecosystem.